Please join me in giving Judge James Fleetwood a warm Pachyderm Club welcome.
Well, I do appreciate the opportunity. I do appreciate the opportunity to be here, although I have to say that when John called me up the first time and asked me if I'd be willing to step up here and speak, a phrase went through my mind that I learned from my dad, and he says, always keep in mind that a whale never gets harpooned until he comes up to spout off. So with that in mind, I will try to share a few of my thoughts. That's good. He asked me if I'd come in and talk a little bit about the court, the organization of the court, how it operates and why it operates. And also at the end, we'll have some time for some questions. I will say right now that I am unable to respond to any questions about any subject that may be presently subject to pending litigation or may be subject to litigation in the future. So don't be disappointed, all right? As John referenced, I do have some significant experience overseas and got to see how some countries, and even countries that are defined and referred to as democracies, how they differ significantly from us and how we operate. When I was in Taiwan, it is a democracy. It does have a constitution. It does have a recognition of human rights, but they are also very much, a military, the military has a significant influence in the government. When I remember walking down the street one time, and you would always see, there would be regular police around, but there would always be, you'd see these people walking around two by two. And they weren't in white shirts. They were dressed in green, they had chrome hats. And they would march in step, and they would just walk around, and you could see everybody as they came by. Conversations would get quieter, and then after they passed, the people would start talking again, or people would start watching what they were doing, and the influence. And so I asked, who are these? Well, they're the military police. Well, you already have police. Well, yeah, but the military police kind of take precedence. So they just march around waiting to see something where they should take charge, and then they can just step in. And as soon as they step in, pretty much all those constitutional rights that we are so proud of kind of disappear, go away. I've seen them take a situation, just a man was walking, obviously inebriated. Suddenly they grabbed him, threw him on the ground, they had their guns pulled out, they arrested him and took him away. And I found out later that this does happen, and people are gone for a couple of weeks, and nobody knows where they went or what happened, and until they show up, and they've got nothing to say about what happened. Now why? They have a democracy, they have human rights up to a point. I think what we try to accomplish here, what we have tried to accomplish from our founding fathers, is to have a democracy that is established and continues on regardless of who might be in the White House, regardless of who might be in the governor's office, regardless of who might be the chief judge. There is nobody in a position where they can make those kinds of decisions on the street corner and simply take away a person's human rights. In Article 4, Section 4, the federal government is required to have, and I have a lot of information, so if I start doing this, if I start talking too long, the states are required to ensure a Republican form of government. And that has been referred to and has been defined as two characteristics. One is that there must be a superior document of some kind that is not subject to amendment by statute or precedent, and establishes the duties, authorities, and limitations of the government. We call that, on a national basis and on a state basis, a constitution. We've established that Constitution, and it is kind of the fundamental primary document that all else is measured by. As I said, it can't be amended by statute or by precedent. One of the primary reasons that this is a document that can't be just changed upon whim or upon the momentary wishes or desires of a majority. It has to go through a process. How does the Constitution amended? There are two ways. We'll only talk about one, really, but there's two ways for it to be amended. One is through a constitutional convention that is established by both houses of the legislature. But primarily, if there is an amendment to the Constitution, it is proposed and must be passed by both houses of the legislative branch by a two-thirds majority. Once that is accomplished, then it will be turned over to through a general election or it can be a special election, but generally it's a general election is held, and there is a opportunity for the public to then vote on whether or not to accept that amendment, and that is done by a simple majority of those that do vote. Once that is accomplished, then the Constitution can be amended. But it's a difficult process. It's a complicated process at times, and it's a process that has its own brakes on it so that these things can't happen too frequently. The reason for the Constitution is to establish and maintain the rights of the citizens of government. Whether they be a minority or the majority, the rights of everyone must be protected, and that's why we have the Constitution. Now, the next point I would make is also a Republican form of government is generally supposed to be modeled after the federal government, which is three branches of government. And everybody, I'm sure you understand that. There's the executive, there's the legislative branch that creates the law. There's the executive branch that enforces the law, and a judicial branch that interprets the law and determines whether or not specific statutes are appropriately constrained by the Constitution, and the acts of the executive branch are also constrained to be within the limitations of that Constitution. But they are given the responsibility of interpreting those statutes and interpreting the Constitution. That's why these things happen. Kansas state history, as far as our government, everybody, we got plenty of people that should be familiar with court unification here in Kansas. Anybody here familiar with how it was back before court unification? Back in 1977, so I know some of you were around during that time. In 1977, prior to that, there was kind of a laundry list of courts that could be created by statute or that existed by common law. And these courts, there could be district courts, there could be associate district courts, there could be separate probate courts or juvenile courts, there could be justice of the peace. And these courts all just kind of existed out there without any centralization to them. And so oftentimes even their jurisdictions would overlap. Nobody, you know, had to kind of guess who do I appeal to from this decision here. Because of the confusion that was created, they decided finally to unify the court system. Article 3. Section 1 was then stated that the judicial power of this state shall be vested exclusively in one court or justice. And we stop, wait a minute, there's all kinds of courts and justices. Well, unification means that there is one court, but that court then can be divided into, which shall be divided into one Supreme Court, district courts, and such other courts as provided by law. And the courts that are provided by law are the district courts primarily that you're thinking of. And by legislature, each division of each district court is an animal created by the legislature and funded by the legislature. So that's the organization of the courts. We end up with three branches of government that are to function independently for the benefit of the state of Kansas. Now, Does anybody have any questions? Good. I'm sure there's comments, but we'll leave it to questions at the moment. How is the court funded? This individual court, the administrative branch of this one single court that is has been created by the amended Constitution, it's funded by the state through their administrative side of the court, which we refer to as the Office of Judicial Administration. They're not judges. They're not they are the people that kind of administrate and make sure that things are running smoothly as far as the physical aspects of the court system. But the Office of Judicial System, then through them, they receive funding from the state, and that it is primarily pays for salaries and benefits of the individuals that work for the court. There's a few other minor matters, but it's 98% of the budget is for salaries and benefits for court employees and judges. Now, the physical facilities, and you're familiar with the physical facilities of the operation of the court, then was just to be assumed by the various counties, county commissions. So I show up in front of the county commission once a year with a budget that we have worked out. What do we need to operate the court here locally? The state is divided up into 30, there's 105, I think there's 105 counties. Those 105 counties are then divided into various 31 judicial districts. Sedgwick County is of a size that our 18th judicial district is one county. However, there are other judicial districts that actually will include up to five counties to create that whole district. But the county governments of each of those districts then fund the physical operation of the court. They will pay for the building. They'll pay for security of the building. They pay for copiers, paper in the copiers. What else do you pay for?
Non-judicial staff.
We'll have certain non-judicial staff that are paid for, and so that comes through the local government. Local taxes covers all of those things. We've always tried to recognize in spending those dollars where they come from, and so I think we've done everything we possibly could to operate as effectively and efficiently as we possibly can. Part of that is that here locally, Sedgwick County has been a leader in the adoption of technology to operate the courts with, and I think it's been very effective in many ways. And here later towards the end of my presentation, we'll talk a little bit about what we have done as far as efficiency of the court operation. But needless to say, we use technology. We use volunteers. We use local civic groups that come in and help with a lot of this work. How are judges selected? The Supreme Court is selected through nominating, and the Court of Appeals are selected through a nominating process. There will be a nominating commission that is created. That commission then will make recommendations to the governor. The governor then can receive those recommendations and either request further recommendations or can recommend from those that have been nominated. Now, that's for the Supreme Court specifically, and the governor makes an appointment from what is provided through that nominating commission. Now, and the same for the Court of Appeals. The nominating process is I wanted to find the language. That's later on. But the nominating process then is then allows the governor to make appointments of Supreme Court judges, Supreme Court justices, and courts of and judges of the courts of appeal. District courts. How are district courts selected? Our district court judges and district court magistrates. That was left again to the Constitution. And the Constitution allowed that judges of the district court judges of general jurisdiction, the ones that try cases, There's a default provision in the Constitution that they will be elected through party elections, and that's the default. However, the citizens of each judicial district have the option of selecting an alternative method of choosing judges, and that is to follow the process of nomination and selection by the governor. However, once those judges are selected through that process, wherever they are, they still have to stand for a retention election every 4 years as the party-affiliated judges would stand at the same time. Once a judicial district makes that decision to go with the alternative route of selection through this nomination process to the governor, it can't be changed except through a general election, and there must be a majority of electorates that choose to change back to party election. So it doesn't change very often. In fact, they had a big push in Johnson County several years ago to try to change from their appointment of judges to, no, from elected judges to appointed judges, and or I guess it was vice versa. They wanted to change from appointed judges to elected judges, and there was a lot of effort and sweat and tears invested in that, but they weren't able to make that change. It's just very difficult to do. I think people become familiar with their system of selecting judges. They become comfortable with that, and change is not always doesn't work out as good as you'd think it would sometimes. At least that seems to be the general feeling. So in Johnson County, then, there is not necessarily a nominating commission. The governor can simply ask directly for anybody that's interested in this open position as a district court judge in Johnson County to submit your name directly to me, and he can select from those himself. Governors, sometimes what they'll do is they'll say, I want the last four presidents of the Kansas Bar, of the local Bar Association, the Sedgwick County Bar Association or the Wichita Bar Association, to nominate. Send me three names of people I should consider, and then the governor will appoint from that list. But that's strictly entirely up to the governor. I know that Governor Brownback liked to have more control over that process, and so he allowed people to make application directly to his office whenever there was an appointment or a vacant seat available. Our last vacancy involved Judge Wilbert. Who took Judge Wilbert's position? No, Judge Wilbert. He was going to come up for election, but he retired early. Oh, Sean Hatfield. Sean Hatfield took the position by appointment. So that was the last time that occurred, Judge Sean Hatfield. Let's talk a little bit about our judicial district here. It is the 18th Judicial District. We cover one county. It is the largest district in the state, even though Johnson County would like to somehow run the numbers and say they're the largest. We are the largest district in Kansas, whether you measure by number of judges or caseload per judge. We are the largest district here in Kansas. And we have 28 judges. We have a little over 200 employees with clerks and probation officers and various other officers of our employees of the court. Of those 28 judges, there is one chief judge. And by the way, I am also one of the appointed officials here. I was elected back in 1997 and remained in office since then. However, as chief judge, I am also elected. And I'm honestly, at this point in time in my career, I'm more proud of being elected as chief judge by my peers and fellow members of the bench than I am as being elected as a judge generally.
it means a great deal to me to have these individuals decide that I am the person that they would like to have represent them, both within the judiciary as well as before the legislature, and to try to keep things organized, and that has meant a lot. Now, we try to let the Supreme Court believe that they're actually the ones that choose me, but we do have a private election as to who should apply for the position, and it means a great deal to me, and I appreciate their support, and I'd like to say that these men and women of the bench right now have been fully supportive, and I've been grateful for the work and labor that they put into this operation. We have one chief judge. We have seven departments. Departments, we have one judge. One department is the drug court and limited action court. That's Judge Holscher, and he runs both the drug court as an alternative method of dealing with people that are having issues with addictions. And he runs the limited action court. The limited action are civil cases that are below $40,000 in claim for damages. Then we have five judges that are, and the limited action judge is selected by the chief judge. We have one judge in the traffic department, Judge Woods, and he is also selected by the chief judge, and he does a great job. We have five judges that select their own position by seniority in the civil department. We have 10 judges that again go by seniority and select a position on the criminal department. We have five domestic judges in the domestic department, and we have four juvenile judges. Judge Smith has been gracious enough to continue in that position beyond his opportunity to choose, and has done great work out there. And I think he also has presented
his. I could have gone somewhere else.
Once upon a time. The juvenile department, then we have one judge that is the probate department. And he handles things like probation, administration of estates, guardianships, conservatorships, care of the mentally ill. We have two hearing officers that are selected by myself that handle support collection cases. We have also three what we call pro tem judges, and these are judges that are appointed by myself for special purposes, such as the small claims court and the protection order court. That would be protection from abuse, protection from stalking, and they handle those matters. Now, that's how we are organized here locally. The Court of Appeals is selected, and they can hear en banc, which means all of the Court of Appeals judges together will hear a case and come up with an opinion. But they usually meet as they divide themselves in three, and they can meet anywhere in the state and hear cases wherever they choose for the benefit and of local communities, as well as I still have some time, don't I? Okay. I see people kind of looking at their watch, and that means either I'm running out of time or I'm boring. So I'll try to. Okay. I will, but they can hear. They can go wherever they want. They can hear as a group of three judges on various cases. They have met in Garden City, Wichita, Chanute, Kansas, Olathe, Topeka. Their desire is to try to get the courts out for the convenience of the communities and have various opportunities to actually see the courts in operation. Appeals. Where do you appeal from? That's actually one of the questions that used to exist before we had the court unification. Appeals from district court will go to the Court of Appeals, and from there it can go to the Supreme Court if the Supreme Court approves. The district court can act as an appellate court itself for cases from municipal courts, and we will and from county or county ordinance courts, and we'll take those up at times. Appeals from we also will take appeals from various administrative courts and administrative officers. The caseload in Sedgwick County, 23,000 civil cases filed every year, approximately, in Sedgwick County, Kansas. These are cases that handle civil damages, claims for civil damages, perhaps claims for injunctive relief, where you're trying to, rather than getting damages, you just want to stop one party from doing something that is may cause injury, has or may cause injury in the future. Declaratory relief, contract disputes. We have, of those, we have 25,000 cases filed annually in, as limited actions. And then we have a large number of cases that are filed regularly for in small claims. Criminal, there are 3,700 cases filed annually and prosecuted in Sedgwick County, Kansas. Those, about 3,000, are felonies. The remaining would be misdemeanors. There are, this is kind of a misleading number, but there are petitions filed, 8,600 petitions filed in domestic court. The problem is once a petition filed, it is filed in domestic court. A divorce case never really closes. In fact, it doesn't really close until the youngest child turns 18. There can always be various matters that can become up, can come up. So when Judge Kirby back here, who is in the domestic department, she will, you know, I tell her, well, you know, there, you get your fair share of these 1,000 new cases filed each year, but you also get your share of a whole collection of cases that may or may not arise, a change in child custody, a change in child support. Maybe there's a question about property disputes, excuse me, or something like that. So actually, it can be a fairly significant caseload for each judge in the domestic department. But they seem to be managing fairly well. Right now, the department is, the primary judge in the domestic department is Judge Jeff Dewey. You might remember the son of Judge David Dewey, who was on the bench for quite a long period of time and worked in the domestic department. And I would say that David Dewey is meeting the expectations of his father and is doing an excellent job there. And I appreciate his labors. Recent changes for the 18th Judicial District. As I said before, we are, one of my big pushes as Chief Judge is to adopt technology, make use of it where we can. When I first made Chief Judge, we had several floors of the courthouse that was filled with these huge filing cabinets, floor to ceiling filing cabinets of files. And the amount of space that they were taking up was unbelievable. And the opportunity to lose files, because a file would be checked out and would not come back, and you'd hear, oh no, I turned that in, the clerks must have lost that, kind of thing. And so those paper files, or they would come back with coffee rings on the pleadings, you know, stuff like that. So we went to a paperless court, and that was my decision. And now we have those several floors of file cabinets, floor-to-ceiling file cabinets, those same cases, plus everything that has been filed since then, now fit inside of a fairly large broom closet. It just amazes me every time I look at that. We've gone to electronic files, and I think about what that has done is reduced the footprint of just the court's files alone from if you can imagine this room to something the size of that bar area right there with the servers and everything. And actually, it could be smaller than that, but for the fact that servers generate a lot of heat. And so there has to be a sufficient space for air circulation and for air conditioning to be able to work in there to keep that heat down. But we developed the paperless filings, and along with that, we needed to give the judges some way of accessing all that material just as easily as they could a paper file, if not easier. So I told our IT department to develop a software that will allow the judge to sit at his bench and to open up an electric file that looks and feels and operates as much like as a paper file would have. So they can look in and look at the images of the documents, they can just look at a list of what documents have been filed, they can look at when things were filed, they can make copies if they need to make copies of something. And it was called Images Quick, or IQ. Came to be referred to later as Judge's IQ. I knew I couldn't say that without a lot of laughs on that. But Judge's IQ works well in more ways than one. But that was the program that we developed internally. And it was interesting because the people that administer they have some difficulty accepting change sometimes, and they were very upset. What are you doing? And so I explained it to them, and well, we're not sure we really want you doing that. And next thing I knew is every district in Kansas says, can we have that judge's IQ? And it was slowly adopted by nearly the entire state by judges using a system that we were able to develop here in Kansas with our own IT talents. And it's been a great process. We're also the first district to go to mandatory e-filing, which I had several attorneys come to me and says, I'm going to retire before I accept this mandatory e-filing. I don't know how to use a computer. I don't know how to do this. I don't need bunches of judges that said, I'm going to retire before I do this. I only know of one judge attorney who actually did retire as a result of mandatory e-filing. And there were some people he should have retired some time ago. not naming anybody. Technology has been a wonderful improvement, and the e-filing has allowed for an attorney can be in his office at 11 o'clock at night trying to get something put together at the last minute and can still get on his computer and get it filed in a timely fashion. Judges can review what has been filed recently anywhere. It also allows for me to be on vacation, literally on vacation in the middle of the Pacific Ocean on the cruise ship, where I get contacted and said, we just filed a warrant. Could you review it and sign that warrant? So I signed a warrant for a search warrant, and they were able to then execute that warrant and do the search and not have to wait until I'm back in Kansas to proceed. So it's been wonderful. Next big thing that we have done is we've shifted from a central assignment to a permanent assignment system. I think it's great. Others might not think so. What we have done is we have increased the case disposition rate amongst judges. We have a disposition rate of from 150 to 200% per judge. That means they're disposing of everything that's new that's filed, plus that much more again in the backlog of cases that was building up under the old system. So we create significant efficiencies in that process, and I can promise you that we will continue to do everything we can to operate the court as efficiently as we can and as open as we possibly can for the people of Kansas, and that they can receive justice as soon as we can possibly provide it for them. And I commit that, I make that commitment myself, and I know that I've got 27 other judges that stand behind that commitment also. I appreciate everything that you've done, and I appreciate this opportunity to talk to you.
Okay, my question is, the courts interpret the law.
Yes.
So isn't it possible for the legislature to enact a statute clarifying the law contrary to the way it's been interpreted? And therefore, not really change the law, but clarify it
That happens fairly regularly. In fact, there have been times when a statute has been passed that is not clear on its face as to what's trying to be accomplished, and the court has had to try to interpret that, and the results of the court's interpretation not exactly what these what the legislature intended, and so they go back and they will rewrite the statute, clarify it, make it clear this is what we want to accomplish. Now, if the court says, okay, we understand that's exactly what you wanted to accomplish, but that's unconstitutional, that can only be changed through a constitutional amendment process. Do you understand the difference?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. If it's just a matter of the statute, you've passed a law and it's not accomplishing what you wanted to accomplish, and we're pretty sure it's not accomplishing what was intended, then we're going to apply the law, we're going to interpret it and apply the law as it's written, but we're giving you an opportunity to go back and modify that statute to make it clearer. Yes?
There are 28 district court judges here in Sedgwick County.
Right.
How many district court judges are there total statewide? Can you talk about magistrate judges versus district court judges? Because talking to other county commissioners, they'd say, well, we have a magistrate judge.
Right.
I'm not aware of any here in Sedgwick County, but I'm not sure where magistrates came from and how they fit in.
Magistrates were created, the position of magistrate was created at the same time as a district court under the unified court system. And the purpose of a magistrate is to have a judge, because it's the state of Kansas, by constitution, there has to be one judge for every single county. Well, something we realize is some of these rural areas where there may be five judges in a district don't need five district court judges, but they still need to have a judge in that county to handle some of the smaller stuff. So they are able to select a magistrate. Magistrate has a limited jurisdiction as to the things that they can handle. They can't try a felony case. They can handle civil cases up to a certain amount without, but then they need the agreement of parties to go beyond that. But a magistrate can do is be in that county and can handle like first appearances, preliminary hearings, setting bonds, stuff like that. And then we wait for the district court judge to show up. This is his week to be in that county to try any the felony cases and such like that. But they're paid, they're about half, as far as payment is concerned, is about half what a district court judge has. We have not had any magistrates in this county. I'm not adverse to having magistrates. We could use a magistrate in traffic, and we could use a magistrate for limited purposes in federal court, but that's a decision the legislature has to make.
Can you guess the total number of district court judges in Kansas?
District court judges? Yeah, I think I think that's right. About, yeah.
Judge, pay increases obviously are very important. There have been rumors this time for many, many years in the district court system that it's very difficult to get merit pay increases. Not only that, but inflationary increases for your employees, judges and whatnot. And is that true? Because
district court judges in Kansas are the lowest paid judges in the nation.
There it is.
There it is. And we haven't had a significant raise in 10 years, one that keeps up with. I have yet to make as much as a judge as I made my last year in private practice, and that was 22 years ago. Now, I'm not here to get rich, but I'll tell you what, I'm proud of the work that I do. I'm proud of the work that these people do. And they should be paid a wage that suggests to everyone that these are quality people. Staff, I have staff leaving constantly. The DA pays more than me. The county pays more than me. Rose Hill Municipal Court clerk gets paid more than I can pay a clerk, and so they're leaving constantly. I cannot keep trained staff because they can go almost any place and get paid more. And it's very frustrating, and it affects the operation of the court, both for judges and we asked for a raise.
Who makes the decision to give you more money?
It's Leo Delperdang.
It is a fight that I have taken to the legislature every year for the last 10 years.
and it's the legislature that makes that decision. But right now, I think everybody here does not believe that their judges that are serving you here in Kansas deserve to be the lowest paid judges in the nation. We do a lot better job than that. I am amazed at the quality of what we have, and I would like to see the legislature respond to that. Any other questions?
Yeah, several of us in this room are part of the Citizen Initiative Project, the movement for the call for a convention of states, using Article 5 to call for that convention of states to hopefully propose amendments to limit the federal government.
Right.
At the beginning, you mentioned, you said, use the words constitutional convention.
Yes.
Was that substantively different?
Yeah. Well, it's a constitutional convention can be called by 2/3 of both houses of the legislature, and then the convention is initiated. They can change the constitution however they deem appropriate, but then that has to be submitted to the public for a vote, and it would be a simple majority, and whatever comes out of that convention then becomes constitutional.
Sure, they can't change the constitution. They can propose amendments.
They can propose amendments, yes. I did say change the Constitution. They can propose amendments to the Constitution. The first process is one amendment at a time. A constitutional convention allows a review of the entire convention and make any suggestions for amendments that are then submitted to the general voting public. Yes?
That's been one of the roadblocks in us getting where we're going because of improper sometimes characterization of amendments proposed.
And I apologize, I misspoke, but it is only the legislature proffers amendments, the voting public approves them. Okay. Oh, way back there in the corner there. I want to say I appreciate you people keeping in mind not asking me questions that I can't answer. I think it's a measure of your IQ, so.
Yeah, this is a question that is currently an issue, but I don't think it would be anything that you could not comment on. The legislature sets the amount that will be spent on various things. The court may direct them to spend a certain amount of money. How can the court enforce that?
You're right. That involves a matter of pending litigation. It's still an active case, and therefore you just waited for me to say something. I really can't. I can't comment on it.
You want to keep working?
Yeah, that's right.
You made reference to the nominating committee for the Supreme Court.
Yes.
Understand that half of that committee comes from the Kansas Bar Association.
Yes.
There are some who believe that the tendency of that group is to nominate people who would be to the left, both economically and perhaps socially, from a big part of this group here. Would you like to comment on that nominating process?
The only comment I really can make is that it can be changed by the electorate of the state of Kansas.
I'm sorry, by
the electorate of the state of Kansas. It's just, you know, it's something, talk to your legislator and see if you can't get them to be involved in that. It's been something that's attempted before, but there's a lot of moving parts of that, a lot of various interests in how it's right now. So, you know, what I say is if you don't like something, get it changed.
Anyone else?
All right.
I get to see you in a meeting about once a quarter. Now, it's Criminal Justice Coordinating Council. Can you give us some insight into what that...
The Criminal Justice Coordinating Council was formed at one time when we were truly in danger of having the federal government get involved with our jail population. We had way too many people in jail. And there was a problem there. And so the council was set up specifically to address the issues of population in the jail. What can we do? What kind of alternative programs can we develop? What kind of alternative methods of handling the population? Are there other things that we can do other than just simply incarcerate? And so this council came together and we actually made some very significant changes. Some of the changes were just in the mere operation of how the court and the district attorney communicated with each other to get things to move quicker. We also came up with things like the drug court and other methods of dealing with those that may have been convicted or charged with crimes. And so we have been able to keep that under control. You know, back when it was always, well, we need to build a new jail, we need to build a new jail, and now it's, we've been able to put that off for many years just by again, achieving greater efficiencies with the court and the other interested parties. It's made everybody that's involved in the criminal justice system has a place on that table.
Yeah, the last question. The nominations for Supreme Court, can the governor completely reject the ones presented to him and say, go back and give me some more?
No, not for the Supreme Court. Okay. Court of Appeals, he could, but you know, not the Supreme Court. Okay.
Judge James Fleetwood.
Thank you.